dans les lieux idéaux, les lieux qu'il s'agit pour écouter la parole de Dieu. So we are in the house of the Lord. We are gathering today to celebrate the power and the presence of our Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. So today, God is always God. He remains God. But you and I, if we pray, if we read and we meditate, the word of God will be closer to Him. Hallelujah. So that's why today God is about to tell you something. The title of this message is No Longer Slave, but Beloved Brother. No Longer Slave, but Beloved Brother. The very extraordinary word in this film is beloved. Because you know about no longer slave, we are no longer slave. The slavery used to be in the past, in the Bible, we know, but now being slave is no longer in power. Slavery or being slave has meant you are in captivity. You are under the service of a master. You are under the service of somebody else. So you can decide nothing at all about your life, about your thinking, about your argument, about the way of life. So somebody has decided for you. And we know, I don't want to take another angle, another aspect of slavery, as we know it's about doulos of God, but it's only about the proper word of slavery, which means being captive or being under the control of a master of somebody else. Hallelujah. So, for example, we know the slavery trade of African, of black people, used to be for centuries, and by the grace of God, it's been abolished. And we know we, as the servant of God, we are the slave of our master, Jesus. That angle, that concept, that aspect of the world is different than what has been in the past or what has been between man and man. So today, God knows we used to be the slave under the control of the enemy, the Satan. And that's why today God wants to remind you, as we know, but you know, in our mindset sometimes, most of the time we are thinking like we are under slavery. Slavery of sin or slavery of the things which are happening in this world. Because we know in the world there are so many things happening, so many different views, so many different thinking. So that's why the Bible says we have to renew your mind. You have to renew your intelligence, because you know we are fighting against so many things, so many bad things, as the Bible says in the book of Hebrews. But today I want you to be focused on the word beloved. Beloved. Beloved means, you know, from Greek it's a kind of doxy or doxa. You know, doxa is about glory, about glorious doxa. Glorious things, which means something is precious, something who is shining, something who we have to praise. So below does mean somebody who is loved dearly. You love deeply. Something is highly regarded. Something is highly regarded. Hallelujah. So we have the example of, for example, Sarah used to call Abraham my beloved, my Lord. So that is a kind of the meaning of the word beloved. Beloved is somebody who you are loving dearly. You are loving deeply. So you can't see his fault. You can't see a misfortune of that person. So that's the way God wants you and I to see the things today. Like the way of Jesus is seeing you and I today. We are beloved and beloved brother. While you say beloved brother, it doesn't mean you deny the sister. So when I say brother, that means brotherly in the Lord, in Christ. We are all the same. They are calling father, brother. So that's why it's very important for you to know and to celebrate today, because you are beloved by God. You are beloved by Jesus. You are beloved by the Most High God. So now you have to be happy. Even we are a human being, Jeremiah, even we are a human being, we are sometimes weak. We are weak. That doesn't mean we are weak before the enemy. We are weak as a human nature. We are weak because, you know, the way things are in the world. Because we know God let the enemy have the control of the world, but He let us have the power, the spirit, which is powerful. Is a powerful more than the power of the enemy. But till now, the Christian, most of the Christian, we are seeming like the enemy is in powerful than us. So that's why God wants to remind you today, you are beloved. So I say, you are beloved, you are regarded as an highly favored. Hallelujah. So God is favored for you. God is planning everything for you. Just take the example of if you love your wife, you love your husband, you have to give her or give him something good. If you love your children, you love somebody, you are ready to give the person something great. You know, you are taking the person like a sweetheart, somebody who is dear in your heart, which you can celebrate, you can try or want to be with the person all the time. So that's why, you know, and today the message has been taken from the book of Philemon. Philemon is only one chapter, is Philemon, verse 12 to 17. Philemon, you know, Philemon is in the New Testament. He used to be a friend, a dear friend, and a collaborator of Paul. He used to work close with Paul. And you know the word Philemon, there are two parts. The first part, philo means love. And Philemon means somebody who loved. Hallelujah. So this message is about love. It's about being happy with somebody. It's about rejoicing in your heart. So now, better than that, now, you know, so many people, they are not ready to love. And we know we are in the end time. The Bible says, in the end time, most of the people in the heart will be no love. The people will reject love. They will reject to love the people. So this is the prophecy has been given by God for a long time in the scriptures. So that's why don't be astonished when you see somebody who hates you. Don't be surprised even if your wife, your husband, or your parent, even your children hates you. Because the Bible says so. We know today the Bible says in the end time, between parents and children, they will not be loved at all. The sister-in-law or the daughter-in-law, she will try to kill the mother-in-law. So these things, when it's happening, people are forgetting about the Bible, about the scripture. What you see today, what's happening in the social media, what's happening in our life today, the people are astonished. Instead of to thank God or to pray to God to prevent those kind of events to come to you. Hallelujah. Amen? I say again. So today, even you pray fast for the family or the earthquakes not coming, it will come because it's been there, saved by God for a long time. But what you can do or what you can say, we can pray that God prevents you where the earthquake will be happening, but you will be saved or don't be there. That's what God said. He said, for the women who will be pregnant in the time of rupture, to do what? God to prevent them. For for them not to be there. The same thing for you and I. We have to pray for God to save us. As the Bible says in the book of Revelation, Jesus said, the hour of trouble will come, but I will take you out of the time of trouble. That's the difference. Jesus will take you out. The same thing, when the tribulation will come, we will meet God, you know, with Jesus. But the tribulation will come, whether you like or not, whether you pray or not, the tribulation will come. The same thing happened when God took the people of Israel out of the Egypt. It was a must thing to happen to them to pass through the desert. That's the same thing happening to we as a Christian today. Whether you like or not, the trouble will come, the difficulty will come, the battles. Somebody who used to be thief, somebody who used to be prostitute, somebody who used to be but today they are sending back to you. Somebody used to be under your control, under your service, but they send it back to you to say, oh, you have to take that person as your sister, as your brother, and somebody who is close, hallelujah, close knit to you. Can you imagine? It's only somebody who is a loved person who can do that. And you and I, we are not able to do that. It's only Jesus, hallelujah. The attitude of Jesus. That's why you have to get the attribute of love. That's why God dedicated the power in order to serve Him in the world. Hallelujah. So just imagine you are beloved. Just imagine you are loved by God. Just imagine that God loved you, planned everything for you, and today God wants you just to be in the church. He wants you just to serve Him. Tell me, what can you give to God to replace your presence in this world, to be born, to have your age today? You are 48 today, you are 45 today, you are 46, you are 49, you are 60, you are 50. Today, it's not by your power. It's not by your parent power. It's by God. So the only thing God wants you to recognize that and to celebrate, that's it. And you do more, and do more and more, because God is doing glory by glory. God is doing the things according to His love, according to His power. That's why Paul told Philemon, and he said, so you have life to keep him with me, so that he could take your place in helping me while I have been chained for the gospel. And God is reminding you, if he didn't do nothing, if he didn't love you, you will be like the devil. You will be like the enemy. But he said, no, I will move him and I will pass. Just imagine the book of Hebrews. That means God said, I will never call angel my son. I never call anyone else my son, but I call you. I call Jesus. And you and Jesus, you are close mates, you are brother, you are sister, you are one thing. Remember, last Wednesday, we talked about eat the flesh of Jesus, hallelujah. Then you become one. And remember last Sunday, we say, oh, everyone in this this universe have a specific assignment, hallelujah. So you see, and God, He puts you together with Jesus. And you must know today, God doesn't see you and I like that. We are human beings no longer. He sees us no longer as a slave. He sees us as a children. And Ephesians chapter 5, the power of the working love of ministry, mission. See, God sees you as a dear child, and you are walking in love because Jesus loved us before, hallelujah, and He sacrificed Himself and He gave Himself as offering for you before God, hallelujah. But that time you wasn't there, that time nobody was there. That time there was no church. for you. That's why he called you beloved. And the same thing Paul reminded to Philemon. He said, but I did not want you anything without your consent, so that any favor you do will be spontaneous and not forced. Hallelujah. You know what God wants you to do today? The things you are doing to be spontaneous. That means do not prepare in advance. And you know, in a matter of fact, is one of the definitions of prayer. When you pray, it doesn't mean you have to prepare a long time before and then go somewhere to pray. And pray is, by definition, is the spontaneous act to address, to communicate to the highest place, which is called God. So it doesn't mean you have to think about, you really must prepare long speech before to talk to God. It must come spontaneously and not forced. Today, so many people are forced. Why? Because first of all, because of the problem, because of the bad situation, because of the difficulties, the disease, and so on. But the people of God, if you are a very good Christian, you are a born again, you don't need to wait for a problem or a bad situation in order to pray to God. Because God knows everything about your life. God knows everything about your situation and is able to give them the answer to heal you or to prevent even you before you notice anything. So if God opens our spiritual eyes, we can see how many demons, how many bad situations come in our life. The plan of the enemy. You don't know about the plan of the enemy. The witchcraft, they are the people in the darkness. And Jesus said, he had authority, authority over all the authority of darkness, all the principalities of the kingdom of darkness. And if you don't follow Jesus, if you don't match the name of Jesus, that means you are under the slavery.
Hallelujah.
But God said today, no longer, you are no longer a slave, but you are a beloved brother. You are a beloved sister. You are a beloved child of God. You must be happy. So why do you do the things of God? Why do you want people to force you? Why do you want the pastors to force you? Why do you want the church to force you in order to do something in the church spontaneously, to do it without being forced? You know what? Because the people are seeing other people. You are seeing pastor as a human being. Yes, he's a human being, but he's no longer a human being that you are seeing now. But you know, he's somebody who is appointed by God in order to represent God. If you see the angle, the aspect of a spiritual realm, and you see it differently, and you give him respect, and you do the things in the church, not according to the attitude or according to the social aspect of the pastor or of the church, of the size of the church, but you are doing according to what you are in the mind for God. If you recognize, so tell me today, if you are laying on the spiritual on the hospital bed, tell me how much you gonna pray to be cured or to be healed in order to go out of the hospital. Tell me how many people are rich people, they are laying on the bed of this hospital. They are not healed. They are still there despite their money, their wealth. How many people? How many rich people? But you and I, today we are healthy. We are working. We can praise, worship God. So why not doing it spontaneously? Why not doing it simply? Why not doing it without force? Just love God. Because He loved you before you loved Him. He prepared everything before you come in this world. He did everything for you. And the only simple question asking you, see, just go to the church, be simple, praise me, adore me. He told the people of Israel when he was about to take them out of Egypt, he to live in Pharaoh. Say, let my people go to adore me, to worship me. Hallelujah. So that's why when you are coming to adore God, you know you must forget about your problem. Because if God is big like that and your problem is just small like this, so you can't see your problem. You see the biggest of God, you see the greatness of God, then and God Himself knows everything about your life, about your problem, about your situation. Hallelujah. Oh, glory, glory be to God. And you see, Paul said, oh, you are no longer, don't see the person as a slave, but is better than a slave. So that means be loved. See him like somebody who can love. Hallelujah. So today, and as we are in working of church, we are working according to the power of love. Hallelujah. Because behind the word love is power. Why? Because God Himself is love. And when we are working, don't see. It doesn't mean you have to be close knit to everybody. Not from your heart. And from your heart, you see God, you see the face differently. That's why God doesn't see the appears. God doesn't see the things in physical, really, but God is seeing the things in the spiritual. Hallelujah. That's why Paul reminded to Philemon, he said, is now of my dear beloved, and dear, better than the slave. Hallelujah. So you can see your brother, your sister today, seem like somebody you can love. It doesn't mean you have to embrace everybody. That's from your heart. So you don't need to think bad things against even your enemy. That, as a matter of fact, the Bible says we have to pray for our enemy. Hallelujah. So what is very important, that's why, and verse 13 says, so if you consider me a partner, welcome him as you would welcome me. Hallelujah. So if you consider anyone and consider the word of God and you keep in your heart the good attitude towards everybody. Hallelujah. Let's clap for our Lord Jesus Christ. And I say, this message has two dimensions. Dimension of power. That means high position. So more you grab this definition, more you grab this message, more you put into your heart, and more you are putting yourself in a position of a high dimension. And the first one is about the heart. You are in the heart of God. So if you consider what I just said about the word of God, and you see you are dwelling yourself in the heart of God. Hallelujah. Just imagine you are dwelling in the heart of somebody who loves you. Somebody who loves you dearly. You don't need to ask anything. If I can say again, you know, how many times the men, they are buying or they bought the house, the building, the building for the spouse or for the wife. Why? Because they love them dearly. Be a good person, but think about Rahab. Rahab used to be a prostitute, but both of them, they did the same thing with regard by God as a beloved, because what they did came from their hearts. They have a good heart. No matter by the flesh, Rahab was a prostitute, but Abraham, he was a good person. But what they did the same thing, but in the sight of God, they were beloved. That's why, you know, even today in the Bible, and when you see the life of Rahab, he used to be one of the parent of Jesus. Hallelujah. You see how God hates? He doesn't see Rahab like a prostitute. He doesn't see you as a bad person. He doesn't see that guy, that crook, thief person today, but maybe tomorrow he will be a good man of God. Just remember about yourself in the past. How was your life in the past? So that's why God wants you to realize that God loves you, you are beloved. The same thing that Paul said to Philemon, you must see other people as a beloved too. You have to see other people as a, the people of God. Oh, hallelujah, glory be to God. So now you are in the center of God. If you are thinking about good things from your heart, you are doing a good thing in the church. That's why the Bible says in the book of Malachi, he said, bring your tithe and offering in the church. Why? Because the church is the house of God. If the house of God, if there is lack of nothing, that means the pastor is happy, the church member is happy, you are paying your bill on time, you are paying everything on time, and you see, God is the one can reward you. Don't wait for the pastor to reward you. The people today, they are waiting for the pastor because they say, I want to be appointed like a deacon or in a position, in a department. Why? Because he's doing something in the church. No. If God called you, and just wait for God, he'll do much things in your life. Hallelujah. So when you are in the heart of God, that means you are in the central of the mindset of God. And you see God, you're going to think about you, you're going to see you all the time. And matter of fact, God, he sees us everything. That the power of God. Hallelujah. So, those are their examples. And you know, God called David the man after my heart. You're going to see that after. But now, the second point, second dimension of power is you are free in the spirit and in the flesh. Hallelujah. So, that's why sometimes it's a very, very controversial point to discuss about if you are a true Christian. It's possible for the Satan or the demon to possess you. Hello? If you're a good Christian, you are born again truly. The power of the demon could possess you. Yes or no?
No.
So why so many people are doing, they are going to look for deliverance every single day, every month, if they heard about convention, conference, yeah, they are running up all the time. And the people, because they don't know about themselves. They don't know because they are dear, they are beloved by God. Have a problem, if the problem is persisting, it doesn't mean you are abandoned by God. It doesn't mean God denied you. Because the people, they don't know about themselves. As I remember somebody, preach about you must know about your identity. You know, because if you know your identity, you know about who you are, you don't need to give the power to the devil, to the demons. When they come, you have the power to kick them out. You can chase them out, drive them out. But if you have a problem, God, the Bible said, you have the power by faith. You can remove as a mountain. So if that problem has stopped you to go further, to move forward, you just remove that. Hallelujah. The same thing with the people. When somebody comes to discourage you, what you can do? You let him discourage you and you hear about his voice? No. You remove that person. You go forward. Move forward. Don't take it. The same way in your life today. You are free. You are free in the flesh. You are free in the spirit. So don't let the enemy, because I know the enemy will come all the time. You come to remind you, you are my slave. You are under the sin. Hallelujah. You are sin. You are nothing. You can do nothing. But the Bible says it's the spirit of God. You see, if the enemy comes to destroy you, but me, I'll come. John 10:10. I'll come to give you life, and I'll give you abundantly. So just go back to the Eden Garden. Why God placed Adam, and you see, he took from the root, he created Eve. He told them the instruction, the divine instruction. But when the enemy came, he confronted them. But the lies. You know? But I didn't have time to realize that it was a lie. That's why the sin came into our life. Stop. But the thing is, it remained there until the last day. The light will be there because the enemy, as long as the enemy is there under his power, the light will be there. But if you are living under the power of God, no matter what the enemy can do, don't put the light in your mind. Hallelujah. So that's why you are free indeed. And the Bible says in the book of Romans chapter 8, from verse 1 to verse 5. Romans chapter 8, and from verse 1 to 5, the Bible says, therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not live according to the sinful nature, but according to the Spirit, because through Jesus Christ, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of the sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do in what it was weakened by the sinful nature, God did by sending his own son. In the likeness of sinful man to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in sinful man in order that the righteous requirement of the law might be fully met in us who do not live according to the sinful nature but according to the Spirit. Verse 5, those who live according to the sinful nature have a mind set on what the nature desires, but those who live in according with the Spirit have their mind set on what the Spirit desires. Hallelujah. You see, you get it? You know, if you are thinking carnally, if you are thinking about the law, you are living with your mindset. But if you are thinking about your mindset about the Spirit, and you see the Spirit of God is upon you, hallelujah. If you are thinking you are free indeed. But if you are thinking you are under the slavery of a sin, that's your problem. But you say, oh, there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ. Read only this first verse.
He has dealt with the law of
sin and
condemnation.
Mais il n'a aucune condamnation.
Pour ceux qui sont
en Jésus. Alléluia. Quel est le verset? Why? Parce que, en effet,
la loi de l'esprit de vie, Jésus-Christ, m'a affranchi de la loi du péché et de la mort.
Exactement. Ok, merci. Voilà. La loi de l'esprit de Jésus, the Spirit of Jesus, it makes me free. That means I'm free indeed. So if you don't want to believe, that's your business, that's your problem. But me, I'm advise you, I give you the good news that you must abide by the law of the Spirit, by the power, hallelujah, behind Jesus. And because you are free, and Jesus said, there's no more condemnation. Colossians 2:14 said, so Jesus, he sets you free, you are free indeed. You know, the power of the darkness are powerless now before you. But if you don't believe, that's your problem. But I want you to believe that Jesus set you free, and you are free indeed. And you are in the Spirit and in the flesh. So you can do whatever you think. You can imagine the things, the project. You can do your life, you can live your life freely. Don't condemn yourself, because Jesus said you are free. For example, you know, a prisoner, like even Peter, when the angel set him free, or you could imagine he's free. You say, oh, he didn't want to go out straight away. And the angels told him, take your bed and go. Because Jesus made you righteousness, hallelujah. Because the bed symbolized the righteousness. But you and I, most of the Christians today, even though they are free, they are going to the church for 10, 20 years there, but they're still looking for deliverance. Why? I know, I don't deny deliverance in ministry. Some people, they need deliverance, yes, but not everybody. I'm talking to those who are very good Christian and those who are born again indeed. Hallelujah. So God wants you to celebrate His power, and you know, in the heart of God, in the heart of God, God wants you to be in the sanctuary. That's why I want to emphasize now the presence of David. The presence of David in the book of Acts chapter 13, verse 22. Acts chapter 14, verse 22 to 23, the Bible says, after removing Saul, he made David the king. He testified concerning him, I found David, son of Jesse, a man after my own heart. He will do everything I want him to do. From this man's descendant, God has brought to Israel the Savior Jesus, as He promised. Hallelujah. You see, now God wants you to remain in the center of His heart, the same way as David. And David stayed in the center of the heart of God, and he did everything from the beginning to the end. And God did everything for the life of David, and everything promised to David. He said, I'll put your son, Solomon. And you know, Jesus came out from the descendant of David, and David had eternal life. The same thing with you and I. Hallelujah. And in order to conclude this message, let's go to the book of Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3, verse 9 to 10. The Bible says, do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practice, and have put on the new self, the image of it, which is being renewed in knowledge in the image of its creator. Here, there is no Greek or Jews. I say, yeah, 9 to 10, that's okay. So now, you are renewed by your knowledge, even your flesh and your spirit, there is no lie anymore. There is the power of God, because you are now no longer a slave, but a beloved brother. May God bless you. Let's clap for Jesus. Thinking. called Lev. Lev, that means the central of everything. About thinking, the central of the beginning of everything. Before somebody speak out, he had to think from his heart. Hallelujah. Before somebody doing something, it's coming from the heart. And when somebody doing the things from heart, he's doing on a good way. As we know, if you have a good work, a good heart, you think about good things. But if the person has a bad heart, is doing and thinking about bad things. Hallelujah. But I want to have the evil thinking, which is about lay. That means a will and or a desire. A will, like the will of God, the desire of God. God is big, and His will is for you to be happy. And the desire of God, God desires for you to be rejoicing. Hallelujah. God doesn't want you to be to suffer. God didn't create you to suffer. Hallelujah. That's why I'm always be happy, because God is giving me, inspire me, the mercy, the good food, hallelujah, for my soul. And I want to delegate the power behind the love of God to you, hallelujah. And to be happy, to be full of the good food, in order for your soul to be nourished and your soul to be strong, hallelujah. And you become stronger and stronger all the time. And when you are stronger, the enemy can be close to you, hallelujah. Because when you are much more strength according to the word of God, you have plenty of God, of the word of God, and you see the power of God will be, hallelujah. Glory to God. The things like that, you must know to do something, hallelujah. You know, God is a powerful God. Maybe somebody wants to, he wants to do, maybe, I don't know, in the library. God is under control. God is a powerful God. Hallelujah. You see, when you are in the heart of God, that means you are the sanctuary of the mind of God. And you know the book of James, James chapter 2, 10 on the book of James. James chapter 2. James chapter 2, verse 23. James chapter 2, verse 23 to 25. James chapter 2, verse 23 to 25, the Bible says, and the scriptures was fulfilled that says, Abraham believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness, and he was called God's friend. You see that a person is justified by what he does and not by faith alone. In the same way, was not even Rahab, the prostitute, considered righteous for what she did when she gave lodging to the spies and send them off in a different direction with question marks? Think, you know, why I always say that when the people are holding the magic books, they are believing 100%. But we Christians, we are all the Bible, we are reading the Bible, but when the things occur, we deny about the word of God. It seems like we didn't read or we don't know about what's happening in this world. So that's why it's very, very important for you to know you are a beloved. You are loved by God. You are highly favored. That means God prepared everything for you and God puts you apart. So before you read, and I remind you, this message are two dimensions of power. Two dimensions of power. The first dimension is about you are in the arts of God. You are in the arts of God. And the second dimension is you are free in the spirit and in the flesh. You are free in the spirit and in the flesh. Why? Because you know the people today, even though there are so many demons, they are able to possess people. But as we know, the Bible says in the book of 1 Corinthians or 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, that we are in Christ, we are no longer in the power of the enemy. We are no longer slaves at all. Hallelujah. Because we are under the protection of another master. And that master is doesn't make us as a slave, but is making us today as a beloved. Hallelujah. We are beloved today. Hallelujah. Glory, glory be to God. So, Philemon, verse 12 to 17, the Bible says, I want Mama Ida, prepare yourself for Philemon. You vois, c'est le premier fois au temps de Philemon. Voilà. Donc, avant l'Hébreu, je crois, oui. Philemon, avant l'Hébreu. Philemon, 12, 17. Yeah, just before Hebrews. Philemon is only one chapter. Verse 12 to 17, the Bible says, I am sending him who is my very heart back to you. I would have liked to keep him with me so that he could take your place in helping me while I am in chains for the gospel. But I didn't want to do anything without your consent. So that any favor you do will be spontaneous and not forced. Perhaps the reason he was separated from you for a little while was that you might have him back for good. No longer as a slave, but better than a slave, as a dear brother. He is very dear to me, but even dearer to you, both as a man and as a brother in the Lord. Verse 17. So, if you consider me a partner, will welcome him as you will welcome me. Hallelujah. Glory, glory be to God. Amen. Philemon 12, 12 à 17. A personal lover but he used to have a slave which called Onesim. Onesim has been somebody who suffered. Hallelujah. Somebody who suffered. And we know he didn't ask anyone to be slave. But he used to be slave with, under the control of Philemon. And Philemon, he kicked him out because he did something which Philemon didn't like. And when Onesim met Paul, and Paul regards him like a dear brother. He didn't look back about his past. He didn't judge him. Paul took him as a dear brother. He said, oh, that person used to be slave. And slave used to be somebody who is under control of his master and doing everything. And most of the time, the slave, they have no time to rest. He can walk from morning to evening and till any day of any time of the day. He has to do something. And that's why. And when Paul met him, he said, oh, this person is no longer a slave. Now he doesn't want a slave anymore because I've taken him like a human being. He's like a very good person. He's like my brother. So now, as he heard about the issue, about what happened between Philemon and Onesim, and Paul said, oh, that person is a good person. He is a dear brother. So that's why I work. He worked with me. I took him like an equal person, like my blood brother. So I didn't see anything bad against him. So I don't condemn him. I don't want to condemn you, Philemon. But what I want to do, I want to send him back to you. So as we are close, as we are working together, and we know we are the brothers in Christ. We are brothers in the flesh as well. So take him back and do not take him as a slave, but take him as a brother. And love him because I know you are a lover person. Love him more. Love him dearly. Love him. Hallelujah. And no matter of fact, we know Philemon, he can represent God. Oh, glory. Because God is the one who can love everybody, and Paul can represent or symbolize Jesus. All glory to God. Because we know Paul, the presence of God, of Paul, you represent Jesus as he says so in the Bible, in the book of Romans. Say, be an imitator of me because I'm imitator of Jesus. Hallelujah. The word imitator means the man. Which means hallelujah. So do something according to the person, according to someone you love, according to somebody who you represent so many things for you. So the same thing happening. So when Paul loved somebody, he recommended to Philemon to love the same person like he loved the person. So it's the same thing happening between God and Jesus. So why Jesus sees God as equal, but he said, if I love somebody, and you must love the person. And when God loves some person, then Jesus must love the person equally. Hallelujah. So that's why Paul recommends Onesim to Philemon. The same way, the things happening today with you and I, we used to be slaves. We used to be bad person. We used to be under the control of the enemy. So it's not by your power, it's not by your side, it's not by what you can do today to become holy or pure. It's because the love of God. Because you are regarded as a Lord, as beloved. That's why you must be happy today. That's why as a Christian, we must be in joy all the time. You know, when you love your parents, when you love somebody, it doesn't mean to show off anything. Just be simple, and you see, and you're going to realize what is coming back to you. Because if you know, for example, if you are a baby, yeah, you are the mothers you are here. Let's look a little bit back to when you have your babies. So tell me what the baby can do in order for you, mom, to love him or to love her. No, I say the baby. Yeah, it's just a baby. If you hold your baby, you help your baby. What the baby can do for you in order for you to love that baby? Nothing. Yes. And only one thing is what? The praises of the baby. When you hold your baby, when your baby smiles, when your baby is eating well, when your baby is healthy. So that's what we have to do in the house of the Lord. Just our praises. Just be there to rejoice. Just be there. God wants to be now. I want to see you. That's what Jesus said. I want you to be rejoicing. To rejoice all the time. And your happiness to be happier all the time. This is the word of Jesus. Hallelujah. The same thing happening for we as a Christian. We're supposed to be like that. The attitude of Paul. Because Paul is talking to Philemon, he said, I'm sending him who Onesimus. I'm sending him who is my very heart back to you. Just imagine somebody who used to be bad person.